ओके, गुड इवनिंग ऑल ऑफ यू। अटल बिहारी वाजपेयी ट्रस्ट अभाव फाउंडेशन की ओर से मैं घनश्याम तिवारी फाउंडर प्रेसिडेंट आप सभी का स्वागत करता हूं। मूविंग ऑन फॉर टुडेज 244th वन डे वेबिनार ऑन हाउ टू बी ए सक्सेसफुल एक्सपोर्टर। वी हैव विद अस अवर गेस्ट स्पीकर कविता सिरोटिया मैम, असिस्टेंट जनरल मैनेजर इंटरनेशनल मार्केटिंग एंड सेल्स प्रोफेशनल ग्लोबल इन्फ्लुएंसर इंटरनेशनल पब्लिक स्पीकर एंड ट्रेवलर बाई हार्ट फ्रॉम दिल्ली। मैम आई वेलकम यू ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ अभाव फाउंडेशन एंड ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स हियर। पार्टिसिपेंट्स आप सभी का भी मैं स्वागत करूंगा और आप सबसे रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा कि प्लीज आप हमारे यूट्यूब चैनल को सब्सक्राइब कर लें, वीडियो को लाइक कर लें और बेल आइकन को प्रेस करें। आज की ये सेशन बहुत इम्पोर्टेंट है तो मैं कृपया आप सभी से रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा कि सेशन के लास्ट तक आप बने रहें। आपकी जो भी क्वेश्चंस हैं, क्यूरीज हैं, तो प्लीज टाइम टू टाइम आप कमेंट बॉक्स में कमेंट करते रहिए, हम सेशन के लास्ट में उसको मैम के माध्यम से हम आंसर लेने का प्रयास करेंगे। और हमेशा की तरह आज भी हम सेशन के लास्ट में एक कोड शेयर करेंगे, जो कोड आपको हमारी वेबसाइट पे जाके गूगल फॉर्म होती है, अटेंडेंस फॉर्म, उसमें फिल करनी होती है। तो प्लीज मेक श्योर कि आप सभी ये अटेंडेंस फॉर्म फिल करें ताकि हम आपकी रजिस्टर्ड ईमेल आईडी में हम ये सर्टिफिकेट टाइमली शेयर कर पाए। तो नाउ आई रिक्वेस्ट टू आवर गेस्ट स्पीकर मैम, प्लीज स्टार्ट द सेशन। वेलकम यू मैम।
हेलो, गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू। अ वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स एंड आई thankfully I am very deep thankful to the Abhav Foundation and its team for inviting me for this webinar. So this is a webinar that is very much important in this current scenario of COVID, because as you all know that we all are very much disappointed and we have a lot of fear that what will be the next and how we will cope up with this current situation. And in this doom and in this grim lining, we can say that we have to work on our skill development. And I am very much feeling privileged and honored that I am expanding your knowledge and I'm sharing my experiences through this webinar. So firstly, I would like to give you a brief introduction about myself. My name is Kavita Sirotia. I am a public speaker as well as a traveler by heart, and I am an international traveler and I have experience in international business. I have worked with more than 13 years in international sales and marketing, and I have been in this industry, and because I'm very passionate about international business and I want to grow business across the globe. So let's start this webinar. And how you all know about international business, I hope you must be knowing that all the countries are interrelated and we are selling the goods. Sometimes we are exporting, sometimes we are importing. But do you know that India is still lagging behind in exports? Still, we are not very much aware how we can grow our business. So if I would like to know that how many of you are a businessman? How many of you work in a company where your company is either into domestic business or they are planning to go international? So can you type yes in the chat box? Yes, if you want to know how you can grow your business. Okay, so I would like to say that in international business, many skills are required. And as you know that today we are facing a difficult and challenging environment. There are risks in the international business and there is a challenge how to rise in exports. For this, we have to have basics of export management and we should have way forward business strategies. So this is our agenda of today's webinar. As trade has been collapsed, and it is not surprising that our industry needs a lot of boost and a lot of morale boost as well as a lot of skill to grow in exports. There is a demand, there is investment, but people are still fearing because of the COVID pandemic. But we have to accept this new normal and we have to re-energize ourselves for strengthening ourselves in the implementation of exports. So we have to look for the way forward plans to grow in export business. There are the current challenges that are in exports are economic slowdown, because consumers are facing a lot of difficult situations and the market's response is very, very poor. And there are trade barriers, embargoes, cultural differences, language barriers, and the distances. Trade barriers are very difficult to beat. And because of the cultural and the language challenges, many people, they think that export is very difficult. There is competitiveness in the market because India is still lagging behind than China and many developing nations. India has the raw materials, India has the capability, India has the manpower, India has the industries, but still our prices are very, very high. We need the verification of the distributors and the agents in international market. If we don't know whom to export, how to export, what are the how we can finalize the right buyer, importer and distributor, we can't export. If a country can import, but there are the challenges, like many countries, they have the forex crunches, they have the restrictions, and it's not very easy to make the safe transaction. As you all know that international business is all about transactions between two nations. Either you transact capital goods or services, knowledge or products in physical form. International business also requires that we have to take into account of the international trade barriers, and due to which our 55% of exports could not be done with many countries. Number one is the economic instability. If we talk about economic instability, we can see that what is the situation of Iraq? What is the situation of Nigeria? What is the situation of Myanmar? There are many countries where due to wars, due to terrorism, the whole government has collapsed. There is no investment, there is no industry. So there is no economic stability. And if we talk about embargoes, embargoes is just a instruction or a instruction by a government that we should not deal with the particular nation because of the political situation or the two governments don't want to work with each other. Like India has put embargo on Pakistan goods. We cannot deal with Pakistan. Third is the OFAC sanctions. What is the OFAC sanction? So USA has put restrictions and the sanctions on various nations on the basis of a lot of standards. Like USA has put sanctions on Iran. USA has put sanction on Zimbabwe, Venezuela. USA has put sanction on Iraq. USA has put sanction on Myanmar also, because in Myanmar, the government is not following the democratic government. Now the military has overpowered the democracy. And Iraq, you must have seen a lot of terrorism activities. Iran is against the USA. So when USA put sanctions, so you cannot deal with the US dollar payment term. Then there is a political conflicts in the nations, between the nations, like Turkey has conflict with Yemen, Yemen has a conflict with USA, USA has a conflict with Iran. So a lot of challenges, and due to a lot of political conflicts, like India has a problem with Pakistan, and India is also having some kind of problem with China. Because of these all political conflicts, there's a direct impact on the business, and business can't be grown. These trade barriers create a lot of tension among the exporters, how to deal with and how to cope up with this problem. And when you do an international business, you have to take into consideration what type of risks involved. Apart from the barriers, there are commercial risks, there is cross-cultural risk, there is a currency risk, and there is a country itself. There is a lot of risk in the country. So when we talk about commercial risk, you have to analyze first to whom you are exporting, either a company or an agent or a distributor or a trade partner. You have to analyze that whether this partner is having a good fund position with the bank, whether this partner is either working with the good companies or this partner is already having a good experience in imports. You have to check the competitive intensity of the partner, how well this partner can execute your order. When we talk about the currency and the financial risk, so there is definitely the risk involved in the forex transactions, because if the currency is devaluating, it means if there is an economic instability in the market, then currency will devalue. There would be no value in the currency. Like you must have heard that in some countries, 1 rupees is equal to 1,000 local currency. So what's the value? The currency is totally devalued, and there is financial risk because due to economic instability, the banks can collapse anytime. So you have to take into consideration the financial and the currency risk involved in that country. There is a cross-cultural risk involved when you do the export business. There is a cultural differences, and there is a negotiation pattern that is different. Decision making is different and ethical practices is different. If we talk about the cultural differences, India is India has a lot of cultural, lot of religions, but our religions do not match with the religion, exact ethics and the principles of various importing countries. And if our principles and the ethical practices do not matches the style, then you can have a problem in dealing with the importer or the importing company. When you do a country analysis, you have to check whether this country is democratic or this country is ruled by military or this country is ruled by a communist party. Because if the country is ruled by a military type of government, definitely you cannot work in that country. You will feel uneasy to work in Pakistan. You feel uneasy to work in Myanmar. The current state of Myanmar is very bad. The military has, they have arrested all the political party leaders. They have arrested all the businessmen. If we want to deal with Iran, how we can deal in the current situation? Because we cannot deal in dollar. We cannot travel. If we even travel, sometimes we can face a lot of challenges in Iran, Iraq, Yemen. So when we are doing a country analysis, when we are thinking about export business, we have to do a country analysis, complete risk analysis. And we have to make a decision whether we want to do internationalization or we want to do globalization. Because if we want to do internationalization, then we have to deal with the few enterprises and we can choose a one type of strategy. And our expansion strategy would be limited to the local business, to the distributors, limited distributors, which will result into increasing the influence of our product in the local market. But when we want to do globalization, we have to look for a one product, one process, one integration, one brand strategy. And that focus is in terms of exchanging the products and services from the interaction of local markets in one global market. So if we talk about globalization, you must have seen the product like Apple, you must have seen the products of Hindustan Unilever and many big brands whose brand name are similar in many countries, So they are doing globalization. And if we talk about the small exporters, small merchandisers, they are dealing with the small importers, small distributors. So considering all the barriers, international risk, political risk, you have to take into consideration whether you want to go for global branding, global export with the common brand, common patented bottle, common strategy. And then you have to think properly, like how many countries you want to go global, or you want to deal with particularly 2 to 3 importers or distributors. That is very important for you to decide before making a decision into exports. And goal setting is very, very important in any business. When you are doing any business, you should understand with which goals, short-term, long-term or mid-term, what goals you have set up. Number one goal, you should identify your target markets and your target clients. So target market, like you have to select 3 to 4 countries first where you want to think that there are less risk involved. There is less political risk, there is less economic risk, the government is stable, the distributors are reliable, the product is very easy to export, your product matches with the cultural ethics and the principles, your product matches and product could be competitive in the market. You can understand with which clients you want to export. So firstly, you have to see the export data. You have to take the export data from the customs, and you have to look for the products in which HS code your product lies. Then you have to find out the list of the importers. Once you verify the list of the importers, you have to understand with whom you want to do business. You have to understand your product positioning and its competitiveness. How much competitive your product? You have to do costing your product. What from where you will purchase the raw materials? Whether the raw material is available all time? Whether your product is as much as competitive with other exporters? And how you will compete with the local competition in the importing country? Because you will be competing with all the products coming from China, Russia, Indonesia, Malaysia, because you are not dealing with only Indian companies. You will be dealing with multinationals who will be giving you a lot of competition in terms of promotion, pricing. And that all in goal setting, your target market research and analysis methodology that I told you, that will work out. And you have to appoint the distributors and the agents after the proper verification of the credentials. And you have to understand whether you want to appoint exclusive distributors or you want to do non-exclusive business. Exclusive distributors means you want to only work with exclusively. You will not offer the same product to any importer or any distributor in that country. But for that, making this decision, you have to firstly ask your distributor how much quantity and how much business volume that distributor will give to you. So exclusive distributorship should not be given to any company until unless you think that that company is prominent and have a good business in the local market. Further, you can think about the joint ventures with the companies with whom you can say that I am making you as a partner in our venture and we will provide you the products. You will have to appoint the distributors and you have the right to decide at what prices you want to sell in the market. So many multinationals, they also do joint ventures in India. Like you must have heard that multinationals like Syngenta, Bayer, Besserv, and many Sumitomo, Mitsui, what they do is they do joint venture in India with companies with the 45% stake, 50% stake. Then they allow the local companies to manufacture in the units and they allow the companies and they have local companies have the right at what prices they want to sell. You can even acquire the companies in the local market so that you can have a local brand naming with you. So you should not waste your time in registration of the products in the local country. With the goals, you can try how you can work efficiently in the export market, because export market is very highly challenging, but it is a revenue-based market. You will get good profits. In terms of profits, you will feel that you are getting good profits, better than the domestic market, and payments can be on time. If you think that your payment should be on time, then you should adopt certain kind of payment terms that are very safe and that are very you can get your payment on time. So that I will describe you in later how you can analyze and how you can work on your payment terms. Where we stand as an exporter, this I will guide you. We have to introspect, like, what we want to do, what we can do in the local market, and how we can enter into local market. So we have to work on our introspection. And in introspection, we have to do a SWOT analysis about our company and our product range. When we do a SWOT analysis, strength, weakness, opportunity, and threats, we have to understand, are our products very strong? When we are if we are trying to export, like suppose I want to export a soap to any other country, and we will think that our manufacturing cost would be this and our finished price will be this. So are we competitive in the local market? Our product quality standards are higher than the local company's standards, because if our standards are not higher, how we can compete with the local market? Availability of raw materials in India. We have to check the availability of raw materials in India. Are the raw materials available in India? Price competitiveness. Are we very strong in our pricing strategy? So these, if we are very strong and we have a strength, then we can definitely compete with any company across the globe. We have to think about our weaknesses. What are weaknesses? Are we having a good relationship with the local company? Do we have an export department? Do we have a leads? Do we have a sufficient leads with us so that we can export? Do we have the sufficient data from the custom inquiry based data? Do we have registration on overseas? Do we have distributors in overseas? So if these are our weaknesses, definitely we will not able to export. And opportunities, what are the opportunities today we have? Definitely we have a lot of opportunities today, because due to COVID, the Chinese companies have lost their market share, especially in Africa and in many of the Middle East countries. And acceptance of Indian products has increased globally. If we talk about the pesticide industry, where I work and I have a lot of experience, so I think that we have a value of around $84.5 billion in 2019, and we think that it would grow by 11.5%. And what are the threats we have due to current COVID situation? Because of the current COVID situation, the supplies has been disrupted. There is a global recession and there is a lot of forex crunch in Africa and Latin America. And many Indian companies itself, they are offering the cheap prices, and there are strict registration regulations in many countries. And many countries are very regulated markets, and there is a lot of cost involvement in generation of the registration of our products and getting the products patented with the global brands. So with all this SWOT analysis, we can analyze where we stand and how we can overcome all the challenges in the export market. So way forward action plan and strategies That I will tell you to become a successful exporter, because I have told you all the challenges, barriers, risks involved, and where we stand, how we can move forward. Because until and unless we don't do an introspection, we cannot understand where we stand and how we can go global. So, number one, you have to rise in exports. I told you, do an introspection. So make a list of the target countries. What are your strong products? What are your prospective clients? And start appointment of distributors. Gradually and slowly, you can work on the low-hanging fruits, the prospective leads you have, and submit the offers to the clients on time. Initiate the talks with them, work on the orders, and appoint agents, buying houses, traders, and register the products with B2B sites, business-to-business sites, and you will definitely find the leads, and you will definitely find the good clients there. Once you have start coming the leads, you have a lot of leads, now you think that I can definitely export right now with any time, then you have to apply for the importer-exporter code with all the ISO certificates, with the certifications that are required in international business for documentation, the packaging requirements. You have to establish the SOPs. You have to establish the export manuals and the logistical documents manuals. Everything you should be in hand, because anytime you can get the order. SOPs, standard operating procedures that you should have. Once you have the leads, you have got the orders. But for execution of the orders, you should have a proper export department then, because for exporting, you require a skill and a training sometimes. So you should have a marketing person, you should have a supply chain person, you have a logistical person who has the knowledge in the logisticals and documentation. If you already have the export department, but this department needs a lot of training and the skill enhancement, that you have to look, because exports is all about redefining yourself, working on your skills and updating your skills all the time. So in domestic market, in next slide, I would like to tell you that there are four P's you must have heard in marketing. So that four P's also plays a very important role in exports. Product, price, place, and promotion. You have a product, you know that this product you want to sell. You have a place, like you want to sell in your United States, you want to sell in Africa, you want to sell in Middle East, and there is a price. And these price standards in international business differs from country to country. The price could not be same, because every country has a different buying competition. Every country has a different scale of economic standards. No one can have a proper one pricing policy. If you are selling one product in $2 in a country, you can't sell the same product in $2 in another country. So you have to think that how your pricing strategy would differ from country to country. How you will analyze, how you will fix the logistical cost, and how you will work on that. And your promotional strategy could not be same in every country. Like you must have heard that recently a Bisleri company has advertised one product where they have demeaned the teachers. They have in a tagline, they have think that teachers don't know how to take the bottle, contactless bottle. So in that case, in every country, there are people are having different sentiments. They have different religious standards. They have different cultural barriers. Everything is different. There is a different practices. All around, you can't say that India and China is same. India and Africa is same. India and Kenya is same. India and Malawi is same. Maldives. So every country is different from one another. So your promotional strategy could not be same. So while working on international market, your market marketing mix strategy will work out, and you have to think that your all the four P's are well defined and well standard. Before going or exporting, you must also have a business planning with you. You will do, suppose if you want to start exporting in 2021, so you should also make a company website, make a list of your products on the website, have a product catalog and have the product presentation with you. With 2021, I can say that you should start working on some markets, non-regulated markets or the open markets where there is not much competition. You can plan the toll manufacturing. You can also work and plan to manufacture on behalf of other multinationals who have the presence in the EU, Europe and Latin America. With this, with 2022, definitely you will get a big breakthrough in big multinational companies and the toughest regulated markets like Brazil, USA and Europe. And you can, meanwhile, you can appoint commissioning agents and distributors gradually and slowly. With the great market push, definitely you can work in 8 to 10 countries by 2023. And I can say that if you today you want to start export, definitely by 2027, I can say that if your product is high valuable product, you can get a minimum value of 100 to 200 crore exports. Considering that you choose the right country with the right distributor, with the right product and at the right time, with the strategy and the value that you want to give to your clients. Way forward approach to achieve the goals. The goals we had already set up, the planning we have done, we have analyzed everything, we have done the SWOT analysis, and we have done everything now. We have to work on our customer data management, how many customers we have, the standard operating procedures, we have to monitor our orders, we have to give the good customer service and the sales related functions to the export clients. Because in exports, the communication is very important. You have to quick and you have to fast. You have to respond to a client within 2 working days. And whatever the commitment you are doing, you should be very honest and transparent. When you are doing the export, time to time you have to do the competitor sales analysis and you have to work on the new markets that you want to export further. You have to do online searching, various tools and methods from where you can get a lot of data and you can appoint the distributors and the agents. You have to sign the agreements with the clients, the memorandum of understandings. And time to time, you have to work on the market development assistance program with your international clients. To support your clients in local sales and promotion and campaign, you have to give them a strong sales support and the stock liquidation program. Regular webinars and the digital campaigns, distributor meetings you have to do. You have to work on the new approaches and the effective pull sales strategies for advertisements and the trainings programs. Like in domestic market, you do a lot of training programs. You go for a field visit. You train your distributors. You train your field staff. But for an export also, similarly, you have to train your importers, you have to train your distributors, you have to work on the effective digital advertisements and the online product training and the product launching. So in next slides, I would like to say that we have to work on the marketing tools because marketing tools are very important. In international business, if I want to go global and I am doing a lot of international business, I have to work on a proper registration of our products online. We have to do a lot of B2B registration, business to business registration with a lot of sites like Alibaba. And right now we can also use, well aware that we are on Facebook, LinkedIn, we are on Instagram. So we can make a lot of videos and a lot of online training programs with our clients. Like I'm in exports, I've been traveling and I've traveled to a lot of countries worldwide. I have traveled to more than 20 countries. So I would like to share my experiences whenever I go and participate in international exhibitions. I came across around 200 to 300 international exhibitors and the clients. I make a list of all the clients and I tick out the prospective leads with whom I want to continue the business. So accordingly, right now I cannot go for international visit. I cannot go for international exhibitions, but I have to do international business. I can do all these things right now with my participation in digital media. Right now what I'm doing is, I'm training my clients on webinars. I'm doing webinars. I'm doing the Zoom meetings. I am training them. We are preparing a lot of presentations for our clients. We are preparing a lot of demos, a lot of videos for our clients, so that our clients are aware. We are giving the product trainings by webinars, by Zoom meetings, by regularly monthly Zoom meetings, and we are registering our products on various B2B sites. Side by side, what we are doing is, we are doing our advertisement in the international magazines and the subscriptions and the journals. Because a lot of exhibitions are being done, and this has created a lot of international market strategies. So in next slide, I would like to share with you my experiences. Each experience has taught me a different lesson. So in first slide, you can see that this is a picture where I have traveled to Myanmar. And this was my first exhibition that I took part in 2015. So Myanmar, you must have seen that today a lot of problems are in Myanmar. But Myanmar is a very beautiful city, a very beautiful country where you can explore and have a lot of good business. So once the situation gets normal, you will definitely can think of supplying to Myanmar, because Myanmar is our neighboring country. Second picture you must have seen, that it's a picture from Vietnam. So where I had traveled to Vietnam, and Vietnam, you can find a lot of factories there, and the pricing strategy is also good. The country is very stable. So you can also supply to Vietnam. Third picture with the pyramid, you can see the Egypt. So in Egypt, I have traveled to Egypt several times, and Egypt is very wide country, where a lot of farming activity, a lot of industrialization, a lot of development, people are educated, people know English. Egypt is a prospective market for mining, for coals, for garments, for pharmaceuticals, for herbal industry, for cosmetics, for pharmaceuticals. I have traveled to Nigeria. Nigeria is a good country but the issue is only about the forex instability and the financial instability. But you can try and have a good business in Nigeria, considering the population is very big. The industrialization is still growing, but you have to think that there are a lot of information. You have to get a lot of information in hand with you before finalizing any country. So I would like to say that you have to be cautious in Nigeria while traveling. I have traveled to Ethiopia. Ethiopia, you must have heard, Ethiopia is a very small nation, but the country is very prospective. There are a lot of agriculture industries, lot of agricultural requirements, machinery requirements, other instrumental requirements. I have traveled to Sudan. I have traveled to Kenya. I have traveled to Singapore. I have traveled to Shanghai around 10 times. So with a lot of exposure in international business, a lot of experience in international business, you can grow your business. Another thing I would like to share with you in international business, what more is required is intelligent question you should very much open to your client. You should have a good communication skill. You should have a good personality. You should have a good written communication skill. And you should have a quick decision making. If you are not quick in decision making, definitely you cannot get your customers. You cannot increase your business if you are taking long time in order execution. And if you don't know about the simple basics of international documents, what are required? The basic documents in international business requires a performer invoice, commercial invoice, bill of lading. What are the delivery terms? You have to have a full knowledge about the delivery terms. You have delivery terms like CIF, cost insurance and freight, FOB, free on board, C&F, cost and freight. You have to have a complete knowledge about the letter of credit. This is called the LC. If you don't know about what is letter of credit, if you don't know about the post documentation requirements, like what is commercial invoice, how to prepare a commercial invoice, how to make the documents. So for international business, you have to have a complete chain of activities. You should know how to do costing. Costing is very, very important in international business. With all the breakups, like what is the basic cost, how you get to know the basic cost, what is the raw material cost, what is the recipe, how you are calculating the logistical cost, how you are calculating your freight charges, how you are calculating your profit margin. So considering all these things, you have to analyze how you will strengthen your international business knowledge. International business knowledge will not come in one day. It will require definitely a lot of experience. How much you invest yourself in international business. And due to this COVID, you can't travel. So you have to be online all the time. Considering there are differences in many countries, they are 4 hours back. In many countries, they are 4 hours behind us. There are 4 hours ahead us. So considering that, even in the night time, many times in the night around 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock, I have to attend the calls to my international clients. I keep them update on WhatsApp. If I'm not replying, I keep them update on time, even on WhatsApp or whatever the medium you want to. The most important thing in international business or any business is that how well you are communicating with your client, how well you are doing the customer service, how well you are maintaining your relationship with your client. If you are not maintaining any good relationship with your client, definitely your client will not give you any order. You have to have a complete knowledge about your client, where he works, what he does. Because you are dealing with a client. If your client is upset, if he has a family problem, so you cannot ping your client and you cannot ask your client that give me order. So sometimes you have to show empathy. Sometimes you have to make a balance between your client and your company. You cannot exactly tell everything to your company. You cannot exactly tell everything what your company tells to your client. So you have to make a balance between your client and company. And international business, your knowledge for the language also very valuable. If you can learn more than 2 languages, it's very well. Mostly I deal with the African countries and the Middle East countries. And so I do not require a lot of language. So that's why. Otherwise, if you are dealing in Europe, if you are dealing in Russian countries, you have to have the knowledge of German language, French language, Russian language. And until unless you don't know the local languages, you must try to have your good command written. At least your written English communication should be very good. Your spoken English, you can manage that, because in many countries, they do not require you should be very much sound in English. You should only know basics of English. basics, like you can tell your name, your about the product name, about your quality, how you work, where is your factory. And you should not be very much have all the British English or the American accent. No, that this is a real myth that the person who don't know English can't do export. Definitely, you can do a lot of things in export if you are good in your product, if you are good in your pricing, if you are good in your quality, definitely you can be the number one exporter. It's my challenge that anyone can do export, anyone can be the number one in exports. So definitely, what exactly you require is you should sell the strongest product in the international business. You should have a good pricing and you should have the better and the best quality in this world. And furthermore, if you want, I can tell you that in international business, there are some other basics also that you should know, is that how you can travel. How you can apply for the visa. In many countries, there are visa on arrival. And in many countries, you have to go to embassy. You have to go to the consular general. You have to apply the visa. So while applying the visa, while finalizing all these things, you have to send email to the consular general. And you have to send email to the visa officer that what are the documents required for applying the visa. Never go on visa on arrival or on tourist visa. Because sometimes if you go on visa on arrival and your visa is not accepted, then definitely you will be deboarded and you will have to return back. So always go on business visa with the proper all the documents in hand, and never book hotels on booking.com or on any online website. Whenever you are traveling internationally, you have to take reference from your client or from valid sources that in which hotel I should stay. Because considering the security issues in many countries, that's not safe. Like I have traveled to Nigeria many times and it's not safe to stay in any hotel. So definitely you should take the recommendation of your client. And while you are traveling to any country, you should not you should not experiment too much. You should not go alone. You should not go in the evening. You should not use public transport easily. Until unless you know that public transport is very good in that country, you should not take a chance. And many more experiences I have in international business, I would like to definitely share with you my experiences. So you can connect with me anytime on my Facebook. I am on Facebook in the name of Kavita Sirodia. I am on Instagram. I am on YouTube. So if you have any queries for the international business, you can mail me also on my email ID. So I would like to say thank you to all the participants and to ABAB Foundation who has given me the chance for speaking on international business and how to be a successful exporter. Thank you very much.
थैंक यू सो मच मैम, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद आपका. अब मैं ऑडियंस से रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा कि प्लीज आप सभी अपना जो भी क्वेश्चंस है, क्वेरीज है, तो आप कमेंट बॉक्स में कमेंट करिए. हम कुछ क्वेश्चंस लेंगे आज के सेशन में. नेहा कनौजिया जी का प्रश्न है मैम, व्हाट आर द स्कोप इन एक्सपोर्ट. वैसे आपने बताया लेकिन फिर भी आप दोहरा पाए तो.
नेहा कनौजिया, आई वांट टू आस्क, शी वांट टू डू इंटरनेशनल बिजनेस, शी इज ऑलरेडी अ बिजनेस वुमन, और शी वांट टू डू अ कोर्स, और शी वांट टू डू अ जॉब.
ये आई थिंक अभी स्टडी कर रही है, ये बिजनेस के बारे में सोच रही है.
ओके, सो डेफिनेटली देयर इज अ लॉट ऑफ स्कोप इन इंटरनेशनल बिजनेस. लाइक इफ यू टॉक अबाउट इन टर्म्स ऑफ जॉब, डेफिनेटली देयर आर लॉट ऑफ जॉब्स इन इंटरनेशनल बिजनेस. स्टिल पीपल डोंट नो that it is a very good field for women. Earlier, for women, it was very hard to enter. If you want to be a business woman who want to export goods from India, so there is a lot of scope. Like right now, if you say that a lot of Indian products, a lot of indigenous products from India, like Indian chicken curry or Indian spices or Indian, like right now, Indian pharmaceuticals, like India is exporting the Covaxin, Covishield medicine. So India is very strong and very a lot of industrialization is here. So there is a lot of scope for India in international business in terms of export and in terms of even job also. So both ways.
Thank you, ma'am. इनका दूसरा question था, ये course कहीं होता है क्या ऐसा करके? ये course
international business actually if I want to share like you will be surprised that I did my MBA in international business in 2008. So at that time, nobody was knowing international business. So I did MBA Masters in International Business from University of Lucknow. And after IFT, Indian Institute of Foreign Trade, only in Lucknow University and Bundelkhand University and now Amity University also offers the course in international business, MBA International Business. So you have to do, it's a full-time degree, 2 years program. They will teach you international business marketing, research, documentation, everything like from basics to everything. But most important thing is international businesses, like how well you are working in the company, because many people who did course in international business, they left the course. After that, they started doing jobs in domestic marketing. So a lot of times people don't give a lot of time to this business. And if you are not giving a lot of time and you are just thinking that you want to do a job for earning money, then you should forget this course. If you want to do international business, definitely you should have a passion for traveling also. If you are very passionate about traveling, you are passionate about meeting new people, understanding new culture, dealing with the different clients and a lot of uncertainty and risk involved. And if you are very enthusiastic people, then definitely this is a very, very interesting course and definitely very, very interesting field. So once the COVID will be over, I will definitely travel a lot of countries because earlier, main har dusre mahine I used to travel. So jisko shauk hai nayi nayi country dekhne ka, nayi nayi logon se milne ka, it's a very good course and you can definitely do international business. I will definitely recommend everyone to do, whoever is passionate.
थैंक यू मैम, इसीलिए बाहर कहा है कि आप जो है वो अपॉर्चुनिटीज लेके आती है
हमारे
यात्रा जो है अपॉर्चुनिटीज लेके आती है और पेशेंट समय से हमारे शंकराचार्य जो साउथ इंडिया से थे वो नॉर्थ इंडिया तक के बहुत सारे धाम से लेकर सारा कुछ बनाए तो ट्रेवल जो है हमारे कल्चर में है. नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन है मैम घनश्याम दसगर जी का. कैन एनी बॉडी एक्सपोर्ट प्रोडक्ट नॉट बीइंग मैन्युफैक्चर्ड बाय सेल्फ?
या डेफिनेटली यू कैन एक्सपोर्ट एनी प्रोडक्ट जो कि दैट इज यू आर नॉट मैन्युफैक्चरिंग. सो यू कैन डू इज यू कैन कॉन्टेक्ट द राइट मैन्युफैक्चरर. ओके, सो यू कैन अंडरस्टैंड एट वॉट प्राइस दैट मैन्युफैक्चरर विल गिव यू टू दिस प्रोडक्ट. That is called toll manufacturing or called P2P, private to private business, in which the companies, they give orders to the small manufacturers. They manufacture the product and you can label the product in your brand. You can fix the pricing and you can export. You can have an importer-exporter code in your name and you can give to any importer across the globe. So firstly, you should have an order in hand. And in this way, you can either work as a trader or a commissioning agent. You can take a commission from the manufacturer also, or you can add your commission and add your profit margin, and then further you can export to any country. Hope he is satisfied with my answer. And because see, there are different mediums by how you can do direct exporting. You can work as an agent. You can work as a middleman, as a trader. Just you should have a product. You know which product you want to sell and it's easily available. maybe it's in your locality or you know who is the manufacturer, and if it's in bulk sale or in economics of scale of production is very high. So you should know from where you want to purchase that or get it manufactured. Yes.
I think how to find not much data.
Okay, so I understand there is not as much as the how to find African customer detail as in Google, there are not much data.
Yeah.
So I understood. So what you can do is you can take the data from the customs. So customs, there are some companies who get the who buy the data from the customs, directly from the customs. Because see, when you manufacture the product, okay, you what you do, you transport by sea. Okay, by sea, every commercial invoice is getting registered and the bill of lading, like that is a receipt from where you are selling the product. Okay, so there is a by sea, either you are shipping by sea or by air. So in customs, all the exporters are registering to whom you are exporting, what is the name of the importer, at what price you are exporting. So every data is registered in customs, Indian customs like Nhava Sheva or any port, any seaport or airport. So many companies, many agents, they buy the data from the customs. And from those companies, you can purchase the customs data and with the HS code. HS is a harmonized code. So you can understand at which category your product lies. So you can search that code and ask the company to give you all the data in that code. And you can get all the detail. It's like a directory. So it's like a directory. So you can search the name of the companies and where they are exporting. So firstly, you should know the name of the competitors, like what are your competitors. So you should know your competitors are selling to which company or which country. So then you can get all the data from the export data. Or you can, once the COVID will get over, so you can go to exhibitions, international exhibitions and the seminars. There you can find the likes for pesticides, there is a CAC. You can go for Agrochemex held in Shanghai. You can go to Sahara in Egypt. You can go to CAC Kenya, CAC Africa. So there are a lot of exhibitions where you will find the right buyers. Okay. Hello.
Thank you. Bahut dhanyawad ma'am. Okay, baat next question.
Fraudsters that I want to buy certain products and we have a big order. So you can ask the fraudster, whoever is the company who is asking you to, so you can ask their website. Firstly, you can ask, what is your website? Let me see your website. So, you are importing from which countries and who are your suppliers from India or who are your main customers? Can you give me the information about your local companies whom you are dealing? So, you can verify a lot of things on internet through Google. And the email, you can also search the email, suppose someone has sent an email from abc@gmail.com. So you can also put on Google abc@gmail.com. So many times, many emails come in the fraud list. So you can verify that from Google also, if they don't have a proper website, you should ask them that give me the link of the proper website, or you can also send the detail of that company to the embassy, consular general. There is a business section where you can ask the embassy to verify this client. And whenever you take the order from any client from Africa, try to secure a payment by you should ask them for 30% advance and 100% against copy of shipping documents, or you should tell them that in first order we will work on 100% advance payment. Or LC, letter of credit, and letter of credit should also be confirmed with a bank, with a confirmed LC. Confirmed LC means the forex, whatever the value of the LC shall be confirmed and the guaranteed by the beneficiary bank. Like our bank in India will guarantee that if that importer will not buy or will not pay the money, our beneficiary bank will pay us the money. So there are certain things, precautions we should take before taking any order from any client. Okay.
Thank you, ma'am. एक important question था, ma'am. घनश्याम दसगर जी का है. वो retired बहुत senior manager रहे हैं. उनका बहुत important question. What is the scope of fashion products for export?
Fashion products. Fashion?
Yeah.
So fashion products. Fashion products, like if you talk about the textile and the garments, so Indian garments are very popular in Africa and the Middle East. The Indian saris and the chikankaris, kurta. So firstly, you should, as I said, that you should start going to the exhibitions. Many exhibitions are held in India where you find a lot of international clients. And start talking to them, and or you can talk to the merchandisers and the buying houses in India who sell to the international clients and very big brand chains. So, you have to think like this product is very unique or not, or we only find out in India, like Indian chicken curry kurtas or Indian handmade or Indian shilp, like Indian designs that are very indigenous and only find in India. So mostly for fashion products, the fashion industry is very much like Europe is very much ahead than India in fashion industry. So you have to think how we are different from others. If we are different from others, if there is a huge and popular demand about that particular product in foreign country, then only you should invest. Otherwise, if it's very local, very normal or find everywhere on internet and the Google, then you should not invest in those products, in fashion especially. Because fashion products, you cannot get a lot of profitability until unless it's very unique and only find in certain states, like in Jaipur, like in Rajasthan, the designs are different. Like in Uttar Pradesh, there are some Indian designs are different. So you have to work on how unique you are, how different you are in exporting those products.
थैंक यू मैम, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद. इसके बारे में मैं भी थोड़ा सा अपना एक्सपीरियंस शेयर करना चाहूँगा, स्पेशली कपड़े से रिलेटेड. हमारी एक फ्रेंड है बैंगलोर में, वो एक यूनिवर्सिटी प्रोफेसर है. वो जो है ऐसे कुछ प्रोडक्ट्स जो है, साड़ीज है या सूट्स है या डिफरेंट जो हाथ से बुनते डाइंग करते हैं. डाइंग जो है वो नेचुरल प्लास होता है, प्लास का जो फूल होता है, कत्था होता है, कत्था का जो बार्क होता है, ऐसे नेचुरल प्रोडक्ट है. और उसको सेल आउट करते हैं रॉ मटेरियल से लेकर, उसकी बहुत डिमांड है. उनके द्वारा बताया जाता था कि वहां के भी प्रोडक्ट्स वो करते बहुत ही वहां सेल करते हैं. बहुत यूनिक से जो हमारे इंडियन प्रोडक्ट बाकी
मार्केट. हाँ, सही कहा आपने कि इंडियन प्रोडक्ट्स जो कि यूनिक है और जो आप ही आपके जैसा कोई दूसरा कॉपी नहीं कर रहा, और आपके में कुछ यूनिकनेस है जो कोई दूसरे के अंदर नहीं है, तो वो ही आपका ज्यादा यूएसपी है आपकी, तो ही वो ज्यादा आप अच्छे से एक्सपोर्ट कर सकते हो. और हाउ डिफरेंट यू आर फ्रॉम अदर्स.
हमारे साउथ इंडिया से उन पावर भी आ जाती है. ऐसे बहुत सारे चीज है जो आप अपने आसपास में देख सकते हैं. और इस पेंडेमिक के बाद आप भी बहुत अच्छे से, मैम ने जैसा पूरे डिटेल में आज के सेशन में बताया कि किस प्रकार से हमें ध्यान रखना है, छोटी छोटी बारीकियों का, लेटर ऑफ क्रेडिट क्या होता है, एलसी क्या होता है, ये सब बातों के बारे में बहुत अच्छे से बताया. और हम प्रयास करेंगे कभी और मैम के साथ कनेक्ट हो, और आप जरूर जब भी आप एक्सपोर्ट के लिए सोचें तो पूरी अपनी सारी डिटेल समझ लें। बहुत सारे प्रोडक्ट्स के लिए नाफेड जो है वो हमारी नोडल एजेंसी है इंडिया में एक्सपोर्ट करने के लिए, उनसे भी आप उनके ऑफिसर से संपर्क कर सकते हैं, और डिफरेंट डिफरेंट और भी बहुत सारी नोडल एजेंसी है उनसे भी संपर्क कर सकते हैं। गवर्नमेंट जो है बहुत सारे इंसेंटिव भी उसके लिए देते हैं, तो प्लीज मेरा रिक्वेस्ट रहेगा आप अपनी जो भी प्रोडक्ट एक्सपोर्ट करने से पहले बहुत अच्छे से पहले पता कर लें, और जो फ्रॉडलेंट ईमेल्स आती है उसके बारे में मैम ने ऑलरेडी आप सभी को बता दिया, मुझे लगता है आप सभी को आती होगी। इवन फेसबुक में भी बहुत सारे लोग फ्रेंड रिक्वेस्ट सेंड करते हैं बाहर की देशों से, और कुछ हमें प्रोडक्ट चाहिए इंडिजीनियस प्रोडक्ट ऐसे करके मैसेज करते हैं, तो इन बातों का आप जरूर ध्यान रखें। मैम की आज की इस सेशन के लिए मैं उनको अभाव फाउंडेशन की ओर से और हमारे सभी ऑडियंस की ओर से बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद करता हूँ मैं। Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Thanks for the nice session you have organized, and it's my great pleasure. And I would definitely like to connect with everyone. And anyone has any queries, they can contact me on my Facebook, Instagram, and on my Gmail account. So anywhere you can contact me, and I will definitely help you out and will guide you in future. Thank you very much. Have a great day.
Thank you, ma'am. Audience, आप सभी से request है, आप ma'am की जो है फेसबुक पेज, इंस्टाग्राम पेज पे आप कनेक्ट हो सकते हैं, मैम बहुत हेल्पफुल है, उनके पास जैसे समय होगा तो वो जरूर टाइमली वो रिप्लाई करेंगे या गाइड करेंगे, तो उसके कनेक्ट होते रहे, कुछ क्वेरीज है कुछ। थैंक सो मच।
हेलो,
ऑडियंस आपसे रिक्वेस्ट,
audio is a bit problem. ठीक है, हेलो
जी, थैंक यू, आप सभी का धन्यवाद। आज की कोड जो है वो 85 है, प्लीज मेरा आप सभी से रिक्वेस्ट है कि फीडबैक फॉर्म जरूर फिल कर लें। हम फिर कल मिलेंगे, तब तक के लिए आप सभी का मैं धन्यवाद करता हूँ। जी
ठीक है, थैंक यू, ओके। हेलो, थैंक यू सर।
परेश आपने ये लाइव कर दिया, थैंक यू आप लीव कर सकती हैं मैम।
हाँ हाँ ठीक है।